to wheel backstage, as you can see, we've got some Airstream caravans. These are the silver things that they kind of bring in every year to Lakefest. And well, it's where all the stars go, and they have their rider.
Well, Toploader.
I say Toploader.
One of Toploader.
One of, yeah, yeah.
What's on the rider?
What's on our rider? God, I think we've had the same rider for about 15 years. I don't know. We've had, it's ale. We've got one bottle of red wine, one bottle of white wine, which is silly because it's sort of always more of us and that. So it's the first thing I do when I get into any dressing room is look at the red wine. If it's any good, I stick it straight in my bag. And then that'll be mine for the weekend.
You must have a collection at home because
we drink. I drummer, bless him, he's a bit of a lightweight, so he'll have sort of one. He must have literally hundreds of bottles of wine and rider beer. So
when was the last time you bought?
Do you know what? I don't mind the tipple. I do actually have to buy it as well. But you know what? It's nice to have a play. I mean, it's such a lovely warm crowd. It's nice to come off and have a small tipple when you come off.
I suppose that's the thing with artists, is what you could do. You could stick your weekly shop on there.
Do you know what?
And every time you go and play a festival, I need some new bog roll.
We did a couple of years ago. We had Honey on the rider because obviously it's a good vocal thing. And I used to literally just get the Sainsbury's Runny Honey or whatever, and I'd take it. I'd take that home because you only can ever put a little bit in your drink. So you don't want one of my cupboards in my kitchen and it would literally get 100 bottles of honey. So we actually take an after rider because I've still got some.
I like that. Take me back to the whole kind of beginning of Toploader.
Sort of knocking about. The first album was made in 99. There's a lot of dance music around and stuff like that, so it's quite difficult for bands to get. We kind of had the Britpop thing, and it was kind of so it's quite difficult to get out there on the radio. So that was kind of why we did Dancing In the first place. It seemed like a very good sort of radio-y kind of track, but I don't think anyone ever thought it was going to turn into the monster that it has.
What was the job before Toploader?
My job?
Yeah.
I did a few things actually. We originally grew up in Eastbourne, so you don't even work in a hotel or a nursing home.
Yeah.
So I did a couple of nursing home things, and I worked for my dad, who was a bricklayer.
Do you ever play in the nursing home?
Do you know what? I did a bit of hotel pub work, playing the piano as well, which my first gig was at 14 and playing sort of TV covers, and they paid me £20 for an hour's work, and I went, this is where it's at. This is going to be. You've got to do this. This actually pays, and you only pay for an hour. Brilliant. Still doing it now.
And talk me through that whole process of you've written a collection of songs. How do you get it out there to an audience?
Well, it was totally different then. Nowadays it is YouTube hits and social media and all that, and that's I don't think we'd have been any good at that, to be honest. But back then it was just playing live and live and live, and we'd learn our craft, if you want, that way. Doing all the, they call them the toilet tours up and down the country and all that, and you really do get to, you get out there and you learn to do what what you're supposed to be doing in the band. So as far as getting out there now, who knows? For a new band, I suppose get yourself an Instagram account and get snapping and selfieing.
I think people forget that, isn't it? It's like they always think that, this band has suddenly exploded onto the scene, that have kind of written this song, and all of a sudden there's loads of gigs, but they actually forget that actually there were 300 or 400 gigs maybe in a year before that came along.
We were talking about it last night, me and Rob Drummond, and we just loved it. We didn't ever think about marketing or management or record deals. We just really loved it. I mean, we still love it, but it was such an honest sort of enthusiasm we have for music, and we always thought we'd get a record deal with crazy blind enthusiasm, juvenile kind of, we'll get a record deal. So we were really lucky because there's an awful lot of bands that don't even get to that point where you can release a record and stuff. So we were lucky we got there. We were so young and so stupid, it was brilliant, carried us straight through.
And things like Dancing in the Moonlight, which you kind of close off with. Is it a curse? Is it a blessing? I always ask this question of people. I think there's always a split line. Some people are just kind of, don't want to be playing that song 1,000,000,000 times ever again. Other people are going, it's the greatest thing that ever happened to me.
I think to be honest, anyone says any sort of big hit they've got is a curse, I think they're lying, really. I think, or they'd be saying it to sort of be cool. And, we could go, we're not playing dancing, we're only playing our own song, blah, blah, blah. But, it's you play every artist in the history of the world, you play your big hits and you entertain the crowd. I don't think it's a curse at all. I mean, I can't believe people are still singing along to it. I mean, there's kids, every year there's another generation of kids that get hold of it on YouTube, and so there's kids out there that know it. And it wasn't because we re-released it again for however many times, but it's amazing. It's one of those songs, really magic. If we knew the formula, we'd be doing it a lot more.
And finally, any top tips for new artists that are kind of looking to follow in your footsteps?
Do you know what? Practice hard, try and enjoy yourself, because it's so easy to forget. People if you don't enjoy it, you'll regret it, really. So no matter what you do, I look back at sometimes and you know, us and sort of Toploader Part One, and we were so serious about everything, and you kind of wish I'd enjoyed it a little bit more and taken a step back a little bit more. So I'd say, to if you're going to do anything, make sure you love it and enjoy it first.